Welcome to Pedo Teeth Talk, brought to you by the American Academy of Pediatric Dentistry, a podcast show that delivers cutting-edge ideas for the professionals specializing in pediatric dentistry.
Thank you for tuning in to Pedo Teeth Talk. My name is Joel Berg from the University of Washington, and today I'm here with Dr. Jed Best, a board-certified pediatric dentistry from New York City. We're here today to discuss dental materials, light curing, and related subjects. So, Jed, welcome to the show. I'm glad to have you on. You have so much expertise in so many areas, but in our time today, we're going to talk about materials, something so important to pediatric dentists, dentists who treat children, and all of us in the dental profession. Materials are changing so much, but you know, one of the things that I hear a lot about, but then we don't know enough about, is light curing. Let's just jump to curing our materials because they have different curing capabilities and different techniques. Is it true that most dentists really are under-curing their fillings?
First, let me say thank you for inviting me. And the brief answer is yes. There's been a number of studies, as most recently as Operative Dentistry published this month, that shows that we have a tendency to way undercure materials. And if you undercure, you're leaving a subsurface of uncured resin, which can lead to lots of different symptoms to the patient, as well as failure of the material long term.
Wow, that's really interesting because I think, you know, several years ago we heard about these fast lights and, you know, manufacturers are always telling us you can cure faster and better, but are we deceiving ourselves? Are we fooling ourselves to think the material's actually set sometimes?
Yes, it's why I advocate to my residents, particularly in primary teeth, to use resin-modified glass ionomer or pure glass ionomer, because no matter what you do, the material has a chemical set, and then they don't have to worry about it. But there have been fascinating studies showing that the actual beam that comes out of the light is altered if the beam is not perpendicular to the long axis of the tooth.
Well, since you mentioned glass ionomers, I want to segue into that. We're going to come back to light curing a little bit later, but I'm also a big fan of glass ionomers, as you know, and you mentioned one of the advantages. Can you tell me a little bit about your perspective on glass ionomers in general and why you use them? I know there are many reasons, but maybe give us some of the highlights.
Sure. A number of years ago, Burt Edelstein was one of the pioneers in advocating the medical model for treating caries, and you yourself speak significantly on it as well. And one of the few, if you will, chemotherapeutic agents we have in dentistry is fluoride. And while the pure definition of bioactivity is somewhat nebulous, and there is no ISO standard for biomaterials, it has been universally acknowledged that resin-modified and pure glass ionomer material, do leach out fluoride, and fluoride does assist in the remineralization and, most importantly, has a pure chemical bond to the dentin, which reduces significantly the microleakage of the restoration.
So microleakage is the term we hear a lot about, but that's really where it's at, isn't it, in terms of sealing and making sure that there's no penetration of bad things into the pulp? Is that correct?
That's correct. And in addition, in 2008, the American Academy of Pediatric Dentistry and the American Association of Endodontics had a consensus conference. And it was discovered that indirect pulp therapy has a long-term success rate, similar if not exceeding the gold standard, which was former creosote pulpotomy. And that is all based on the fact that once you remove what is called the infected dentin and you leave affected dentin, as long as you have a chemical bond to the dentin, the process will not progress towards the pulp. And the only material that we have, in fact, that does have that chemical bond is glass ionomer.
So when you do a deep restoration, whether it's whatever kind of restoration you're doing, and you feel like you're close to the pulp, which we often are, you would say that glass ionomer is the best material to use in that situation.
I would actually go a little farther and say I do not put composite in primary teeth, and I will base a permanent tooth with glass ionomer. I find it illogical that my colleagues use composite. Composite is a hydrophobic material. Glass ionomer is a hydrophilic material. We all sort of use rubber dam, and when we use rubber dam, it's a figure eight ligation. I jokingly say that God created the mesials of canines to hold the anterior part of the rubber dam, and you get cellular infiltration.
That's true.
So why are you putting in a material that doesn't like water when you've got saliva swimming around the prep?
Yeah, and I think, you know, as I often say, the glass ionomer is like a good dentin substitute because it has all those properties of dentin. But you would agree that if one chose to use the so-called sandwich technique, they could place composite above, particularly more in an aesthetically visible area, and place glass ionomer on the deepest parts?
Of course, although I would add that there are several new glass ionomers, one Ionolux, another Keytec Nano, that has glass filler particles incorporated in it, and I defy anybody once it's placed to find it. Its aesthetics is really quite outstanding.
So what are, since you mentioned the newer materials, and I know they are a lot better, and people who haven't used glass ionomers in some time may not be aware of the quality of the currently available glass ionomers. First of all, Jed, what's the difference between, you know, what you referred to a traditional glass ionomer and a resin-modified glass ionomer? What are the differences between those two materials?
Well, resin-modified glass ionomers have resin, which gives you an initial cure so that the patient walks out of your office with the filling material hard. Pure glass ionomer is a pure chemical reaction. The trend is to go to higher viscosity glass ionomers, but the manufacturers suggest that that takes about 2.5 minutes to cure to get hard, and we all know that little kids don't have that kind of patience. As an aside, there have been some studies, mostly in Europe, where using even a light curing agent, actually, the light, can drive the reaction farther to the right and faster, so that instead of curing in 2.5 minutes, you can cure it in about 70, 80 seconds, which is significantly more than a resin modified, but significantly less than the manufacturer's instructions.
So you're speeding up the rate of cure of a traditional glass ionomer, that chemical reaction, that acid-base reaction, just by the heat that comes from the end of the light. That's what you're saying.
Exactly, correctly. And it also increases the micro-hardness of the outer surface. Most of these papers are the ones that I've read are coming out of the dental school in Amsterdam. And they seem pretty conclusive that and I've used it in my practice for a number of years, and it works. I mean, you must test the particular material with your light, but I've yet to find any material that hasn't worked with the lights that I presently own.
So given that advantage of using a light to heat up and expedite the cure of a traditional glass ionomer, which is a problem, especially in young kids, as you mentioned, can you give me some examples of when you would use a traditional glass ionomer still today versus the currently available resin-modified glass ionomers?
I mean, I tend to use it more as a base. One of the problems that I find with resin-modified sometimes is while they're not as technique-sensitive, if you will, as composites, they sometimes leave a radiolucent line underneath the base. I don't seem to find that with pure glass ionomers. If I want a significant amount of fluoride release, I tend to want to use the pure glass ionomers a little bit more. If I want aesthetics, which is most of the time, in fact, certainly in my practice in Manhattan, I'm using a resin modified.
So regarding the resin modified glass ionomers versus the traditional glass ionomers, you mentioned you would use the traditional glass ionomer as a base primarily, perhaps with a resin modified above it because of the properties differences between the two. Is that correct?
Yeah, if it's a really deep prep, not on primary teeth but permanent teeth, I personally just feel a little bit secure that there's no resin and the subsequent exothermic reaction that the resin occurs. And I'm also somewhat worried of the initial lack of curing, because if the prep's really deep, and depending upon the light that I'm using, that particular material won't cure immediately as hard as I would wish, whereas I know that the pure glass ionomer is going to cure hard because it's a chemical reaction and it's totally light independent.
So when you cure that resin-modified glass ionomer, and I talk to people about this all the time, you're curing the resin component, but the glass ionomer acid-base reaction within that resin-modified glass ionomer continues to take place after the visible cure that you get with the light. Is that fair to say?
Yes, and that's why I think resin modifieds are, A, highly underutilized in all of dentistry, particularly in pediatric dentistry, and it's the closest we have at the moment to an ideal restorative material in primary teeth.
So going back to those deep restorations we talked about earlier, you mentioned you would likely use a resin, you would use a resin modified glass ionomer or a traditional glass ionomer. Is there any situation you would use a resin modified directly on the deep restoration, or you would always use the traditional glass ionomer?
No, I would often use a resin modified, particularly if the child's a little ootsie and I got to get in and out pretty quickly. I can tell you I've probably, In the last 20 years, the number of pulpotomies I've done, you can count them on one hand, mostly because I'm doing indirect pulp therapy with the resin-modified glass ionomers for aesthetics. Pure glass ionomers tend to be more opaque, whereas the resin-modifieds with glass silica particles tend to be very aesthetic.
I think I'm going to have to refer to my Urban Dictionary to look up Utsi later, but we'll take care of that.
Sorry.
No, that's okay. It's a good one. I like to learn something new every day. So let's talk a little about resin-modified glass ionomers. You know, the word on the street many years ago, and you referred to some of the modern materials a moment ago, was that they tend to wear, and that the wear is significant enough that you may have to either replace the restoration, especially in a marginal ridge area of a class 2 restoration. Is that still the case today?
I have to confess, you know, I have friends who are engineers, material engineers in both the two companies that I mentioned. I have no financial arrangements with either of them. I use the material because I think it's terrific, and I have not seen any problem with wear with either of those two materials in particular.
So you followed these for years after placing in your practice and do not have that problem with wear whatsoever?
That's correct. I mean, I'm not doing assays of how many come in, but empirically, unless it's a catastrophic breakaway from the tooth, which is usually my fault because I haven't adjusted occlusion, I'm just not seeing significant wear on these teeth.
So I want to talk to you a little bit about placing the glass ionomer restorations. Now we're talking about a small class 2 restoration in a primary tooth where you said you would generally use a resin-modified glass ionomer. People talk about these RMGIs as being sticky. They are kind of sticky in consistency. Do you agree with that? And if so, how do you get around that in terms of clinical placement?
Yes, I agree. I learned a trick from Teddy Kroll, particularly with Keytec Nano, is that once it's mixed, I wait 30 seconds. My assistant is mixing it while I am putting on the primer. And by the time I've done with that, she's ready to hand me the syringe. I don't use the applicator. The applicator is used to mix, and then we put it in a centric syringe. With Ionolux, the lumen is small enough that I can just, once I have it in the injector, it goes straight into the tooth. And then I take some sort of bonding agent and go across the tooth, never vertically, but across, which tends to smooth out the material and doesn't pull it away from the prep. I then cure the occlusal, take the band off the tooth, and then I then cure from the buccal and the lingual.
Okay, so how much time do you spend curing since you referred to that?
Maximum of about 30 seconds. I do 10, 10, and 10. Sometimes it's 15, 10, and 10. But I want to make sure I've cured the resin completely down towards the box, and that seems to work pretty well.
So you gave me a nice segue back to light curing that we started with. How does a dentist know that they've light cured enough?
They don't. They only know it when the problems come up. The biggest problem with light curing, and dentists don't seem to be aware of this, is that there are two major types of lights. There's what's called a polywave light, and there's a monowave light. The monowave light basically is aimed at a photoinitiator called camphorquinone, which reacts to blue light. However, the polywave has a violet LED in it, and unfortunately, the dentists don't know what the photoinitiator in the particular composite that they're using, which it reacts to. Violet LEDs also don't penetrate the tooth nearly as deeply as blue light does. So if you're bulk filling a material and you're using a predominant violet light, you may have some trouble. And in addition, the manufacturers in their marketing will advertise that they have a wide spread of wavelengths that they cure, but they're not identifying whether or not it's a blue LED, violet LED, or a combination. Most of the polywaves are obviously a combination, but you don't know how many. Are there three blue to two violet? Is there one to three? In addition, you don't know where that LED is placed. So you could be rotating the light and on a material that sets with blue light, and you've got your violet LED right on top of the tooth.
Wow. I didn't learn about poly and mono wave lights in dental school. I don't know about you. So is that some new concept or something we should have been aware of all along?
I think it's been around for maybe 5-10 years. I certainly didn't learn it in dental school. You know, I sort of spend one of my off times reading a lot of materials research. It's what I did when I was in dental school as well. And most of this literature is not in the mainstream dental literature. It's in the research literature.
Wow. That's really interesting. So the other material that I'm familiar with is called phosphine oxide. That's, I think, SB a long time ago patented that, the other photo initiator. Mm-hmm. But that one, I think, is in the poly range. And then there may be others now, too. But you're right. I think dentists should be aware of, does the light they have, I guess this is the question you're raising, make sure the light that you have is in the range of what the material demands in terms of the curing. Is that a fair way of saying it?
Yes, that's definitely fair. And the other thing that people don't realize is that their radiometers that they're using to measure their light are significantly inaccurate. And there's only one device that I know of on the market that actually measures not only the amount of irradiance coming out of your light, but they put a 6-millimeter sleeve and they test again so you can get a sense of how much irradiance is coming to the base of your box. The nice thing about that particular device, and I'm not plugging 3M, but 3M made arrangements with the manufacturer and they will come to your office for free of charge and test your lights. They've done it for mine. That's nice to know.
I suppose most of the manufacturers should be willing to do that, right? If their light is doing what it's supposed to do, then they all should be willing to do what you just said to guarantee the integrity of the curing, right? That's what we need to accomplish.
Yes. Unfortunately, there have been a number of studies, particularly in IADR, which show that the variance of the efficiency of those lights is significant. And there's a lot of lights that plus or minus their margin of error is pretty large. So what the manufacturers are claiming may not necessarily be accurate.
Okay. Well, you've given us a good thing to think about to make sure that we have the right light for the right material and that it's curing with the right amount of energy for the material and the photoinitiator in the resin material that we're curing. That's really important. I think we tend to get sort of cavalier. We do these every day. We forget this is a chemical process, a scientific process, and you're reminding us of all those things. I want to talk a little bit about composites. I know that, you know, when you talk about resin-modified glass ionomers, you know, you're talking about materials which are actually containing resin and glass ionomer, so they have some characteristics of composite, but true composites don't have glass ionomer in them. So you mentioned earlier that you like to use resin-modifieds as a restorative material in primary teeth and not composites because of their hydrophobicity. When do you use composite in your practice? I know you treat other patients well.
Particularly on a permanent tooth, but I will use a glass ionomer as the dentin replacement, so it's a sandwich technique, and then I'll use the composite above that. There is some controversy, I feel, with bulk filling on composite, and this removes that controversy. You can still incrementally place the composite, which is still the gold standard, but the amount that you have to place is much less, the depth is much less, and you've got a chemical bond to the dentin. And in essence, it's sort of what Ted Kroll has advocated for years, that glass ionomer in that case is a dentin replacement and the composite is an enamel replacement.
Yeah, it sounds so easy. And I think that, you know, when I talk to audiences as well, they do hear this. You know, it's interesting that since 1985, since resin bonding agents have been on the market in the United States, they have been promulgated, in my view, at the expense of glass ionomers. Because I think what I'm hearing from you as well, Jed, is that glass ionomers are an adhesive. So the bonding agent, although you have to have some adhesion, they have a chemical adhesion, as you referred to earlier.
Yes, I agree.
Yeah. I want to go back to rubber dam. You mentioned, you know, one of the advantages of glass ionomers is that they're hydrophilic, which they are, and the only material that has water in the restorative material itself. So they're compatible with the dentin and the enamel. I know you're also, like me, a big rubber dam fan, so you do recommend a rubber dam for restorative materials, but how does the use of rubber dam differ with glass ionomer versus composite?
Probably not. I think the technique and the ability to keep the tooth dry is far more significant if you're using composite than you're using rubber dam. One area of concern that I have, but I've yet to see any studies with respect to this, is the trend a lot of times now is to use something like an isolite. And I don't know if the moisture that's in the mouth is affecting anything in terms of the adhesive bond of the composite to the tooth structure. I am now presently looking in journals to see if I can find anything to that effect, but I have yet to do it. Whereas the glass ionomer, you don't have to worry about it because if you're getting lack of moisture control, if you're getting a mist coming from the mouth, the glass ionomer is still going to set. It's still going to bond to the dentin.
So are we referring to the humidity, when a patient breathes, the condensation gets on a mirror when you put the mirror in the mouth. So that same condensation is probably getting on the cavity prep, notwithstanding the actual liquid that you see.
Correct.
And that's where the rubber dam is probably not probably clearly advantageous over something like an isolate. That's what I think you're saying.
Yes, I can't prove it. It's just something that I think is happening. I yet to have found a study that validates that feeling of mine yet.
So we've covered curing, we've covered glass ionomers, great materials, we've covered resin modifieds, wonderful materials for pediatric dentistry, and we've talked about composites. As a last question, I want to talk a little bit about a phrase that's often heard related to glass ionomers, but perhaps other materials, is bioactivity. You know, you hear that, I know it makes you laugh. Some people talk about, you know, a bioactive material. I want to hear your thoughts on that and, you know, how it's been used and what does it mean in terms of glass ionomers and other materials.
excuse me, I'm laughing because it's probably the most hyped thing in dentistry at the moment. I have already discovered 7 separate definitions for bioactivity from my colleagues in the material science and materials business industry. There is no consensus for what's bioactive. There is, at the moment, one major ISO standard. It's 23317-2014. It makes no mention of dental materials. It's for artificial bone. They have just announced a new standard, 19090, that's still under development, and that became effective January 1 of 2018. I think the closest thing at the moment that we have to our actual bioactive material is MTA and the MTA derivatives. With respect to resin-modified glass ionomers, the definitions are all over the place. But, you know, some of these manufacturers, I find it fascinating because some of these manufacturers, when they apply to the FDA for their approval, use a process called 510K, otherwise known as a predicate. And they are comparing their material to other glass ionomers, and then they claim that their glass ionomer is bioactive and the others aren't. Well, that is illogical. If they're similar to another resin-modified glass ionomer, then they're both bioactive by that definition. But I think that the definition of bioactivity for materials is yet to be proven.
Well, you've given us some amazing stuff to think about. And I think the collective message I'm hearing from you, Dr. Best, is let's be cognizant of what we're doing when we place restorative materials in children. We're doing small restorations, but they make a big difference to our patients. And we have to think about sealing. We have to think about light curing. We have to think about bonding. All those things. So I really appreciate the expert advice, and I think you've given us something we can take to our practices right away. So thank you very much, Jed, for being on Pedo Teeth Talk with me today. And I thank the American Academy of Pediatric Dentistry. And finally, a big thank you to our listeners for tuning in today.
Pedo Teeth Talk is brought to you by the American Academy of Pediatric Dentistry, the show that delivers cutting-edge ideas for the professional specializing in pediatric dentistry. If you have any questions or comments, please email info@aapd.org. We welcome your ideas for future shows and guests. For more information on the American Academy of Pediatric Dentistry, visit aapd.org.